Friday. Today we began Juz 3, the third Juz of the Quran, and we recited Ayatul Kursi. And every one of us knows Ayatul Kursi. Every one of us, inshaAllah ta'ala, has memorized Ayatul Kursi. And if anybody has not memorized it, then they definitely should memorize Ayatul Kursi. Why is Ayatul Kursi so important? What is so blessed about Ayatul Kursi? There are so many ahadith that tell us the blessings of Ayatul Kursi. Of them is the hadith of Ubayy ibn Ka'b in Sahih Bukhari, that once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to him. And Ubayy was, as we already mentioned yesterday, one of the most knowledgeable companions about the Quran. So the Prophet ﷺ asked Ubayy, "O Ubayy, which ayah in the Quran is the most blessed ayah? It is the greatest ayah. أَعْظَمُ آيَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ." So Ubayy did not want to respond out of modesty. So he said, "Allah and His Messenger know best. Allah and His Messenger know best." So the Prophet ﷺ insisted, "O Ubayy, what is the greatest ayah in the Quran?" So when Ubayy realized the Prophet wants a response, so he said, "Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum, la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm, lahu ma fi as-samawati wa ma fi al-ard, man dha alladhi yashfa'u 'indahu illa bi'idhnihi, li'alamu ma bayna aydihim wa ma khalfahum, wa la yuhituna bi shay'in min 'ilmihi illa bima sha'a, wasi'a kursiyyuhu as-samawati wal ard, wa la ya'udu hifdhuhuma wa huwa al-'aliyyu al-'azim." When Ubayy said this, the Prophet he pushed him gently, yani as a sign of manliness, like it's what we would do to another man, just push him out of pride, out of happiness, and he said, "Liyahnika al-'ilmu ya Aba al-Munzir," that knowledge shall always be — this is difficult to translate, but it's basically, knowledge will always be happy around you. Or may you always be given glad news of knowledge. Or you and knowledge are always going to be happy together. Some type of phrase like this, right? So you and knowledge go hand in hand, and may you be congratulated for your knowledge. This is one of the ways to put it together. So this shows us that the Prophet ﷺ agreed with Ubayy ibn Ka'b that indeed, the greatest ayah in the entire Quran is Ayatul Kursi. أَعْظَمُ آيَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ told Abu Huraira that he had gotten a lot of charity. This hadith happened in Ramadan. So this is Ramadan, this hadith also happened in Ramadan. That the people in Ramadan gave their sadaqah. Because Ramadan is the time when we give sadaqah. And later on, inshallah, even here at us at MIC, we will announce to you we're accepting zakat and sadaqat in Ramadan as well. So the Prophet ﷺ accepted a lot of sadaqah. So he said to Ubayy, "O Ubayy, go guard the sadaqah in case somebody steals it all night." Abu Huraira. So Abu Huraira went and he guarded the sadaqah. And he fell asleep. When he woke up, he saw somebody stealing some food, something. So he caught him. And the man began to cry, beg, plead, "I have a family, I have food to eat, I'm hungry, I'm starved, please, just forgive me once, I'll never come back again." So Abu Huraira had pity on him. He was very wily, sneaky, crafty. Abu Huraira felt pity, he let him go. So the next morning, the Prophet ﷺ asked him, "What happened with your visitor?" He already knew. "What happened with your visitor?" So Abu Huraira said, "O Messenger of Allah, he was a poor man. He begged, he pleaded, I let him go." The Prophet ﷺ said, "He's going to come back again." So Abu Huraira felt, how did the Prophet ﷺ know? I have to make sure that this time I catch him and I bring him to the Prophet ﷺ. So this time he was on his guard. Lo and behold, he fell asleep, woke up, the man was right in the middle, getting what he could, grabbing what he could. This time Abu Huraira jumped on him. He goes, "Wallahi, I'm going to take you to the Prophet ﷺ." And the man began to beg and plead and cry and this and that, so long and so persistent that Abu Huraira once again felt sympathy for him. And he once again let him go. In the next morning, the Prophet ﷺ again said, "How was your visitor of last night, O Abu Huraira?" So this time Abu Huraira said, "Khalas, that's it. Three strikes and you're out," right? So on the third night, he stood up and he didn't fall asleep. He managed to catch him. Now, after begging and pleading did not work, the visitor said, "Okay, will you let me go if I tell you something that will benefit you for the rest of your life?" He said, "What is it? Well, let me hear what this is." So he said, "When you go to sleep, recite Ayatul Kursi. Because as long as you recite Ayatul Kursi at night, Allah Azza wa Jal will send a hafiz, a protector, to guard over you for the whole night. Nothing can harm you." So when Abu Huraira heard this, he felt this is a big prize, a big treasure. So he let him go. The next morning, the Prophet ﷺ said, "What happened with your visitor, Abu Huraira?" And Abu Huraira told him the whole story. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "O Abu Huraira, صَدَقَكَ وَهُوَ كَذُوبٌ. He told you a truth now, but he is a habitual liar. This guy is a filthy liar, but this time he told you the truth. صَدَقَكَ وَهُوَ كَذُوبٌ. He's a كَذُوب, not just كَذِب, كَذُوب. He always lies, but this time he told you the truth. Do you know who your visitor was?" Abu Huraira said, "No." He said, "That was shaitan. Your visitor was shaitan. That he wanted to steal from the sadaqah and he begged and pleaded his lies, you believed him. But the third time he told you the truth." What was the truth? If you recite Ayatul Kursi, then nothing will harm you. No jinn, no waswas, no evil, nothing will harm you for the entire night. Allah will send an angel down to protect you. So we learn from this hadith that before we go to sleep, we need to recite Ayatul Kursi every single night. Our Prophet ﷺ, before going to bed, he would recite Ayatul Kursi on himself. Right? So Ayatul Kursi is the greatest ayah in the book of Allah. Ayatul Kursi is to be recited every night. In one hadith, we learn also the Prophet ﷺ said, Sunan al-Nisa'i, he said that Ayatul Kursi should be recited in the morning and the evening. We call them the adhkar of the sabah and masa. There were certain adhkar the Prophet would do in the morning anytime, basically from fajr to dhuhr. And then there were other adhkar he would do in the evening, basically from asr to maghrib, anytime. He would just do these adhkar. So Ayatul Kursi was of those that he would recite it twice in the morning and evening. And in one other hadith reported in Muslim Imam Ahmad, that it is also authentic, our Prophet ﷺ said that man qara'a Ayatul Kursi dubura kulli salatin, that whoever recited Ayatul Kursi after every single salah, لَمْ يَمْنَعْهُ مِنْ دُخُولِ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا الْمَوْتِ. The only thing preventing him from entering Jannah is his own death. This is one of the most beautiful ahadith that I want you all to memorize and then act upon. Beginning from today. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? Whoever recites Ayatul Kursi after every single fard salah. So before you stand up and you finish your fard salah, before you go to your worldly affairs, go back home, go to your work, you stay seated, you do the adhkar, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, you do all of that. When you finish all of that, then you recite Ayatul Kursi. And if you make this a habit and a routine, what did our Prophet ﷺ say? Nothing will prevent a person from entering Jannah except his own death. Meaning, you are a person of Jannah if you recite Ayatul Kursi after every of the five salawat, which of course means you better be praying five times a day. That's understood in the hadith, right? You must be praying five times a day and then you recite Ayatul Kursi after every single salah. Now, why? What is so special about this Ayatul Kursi? It is but one ayah. It is one third of a page. And there are so many other verses of the Quran. The Quran has over 6,000 something verses. Why does this verse stand out so much? The response is very simple. It is because the verse deals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His names and attributes. And always the most majestic verses and the most blessed verses in the Quran are the verses that talk about Allah Azza wa Jal. Why? Because nothing is more grandiose to discuss, more majestic to discuss, more beautiful to discuss than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no topic that is more worthy of being talked about and praised other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the best verses in the Quran are those verses that praise Allah. And the best surah in the Quran is the surah that is nothing but a praise and description of Allah, and that is Surah Al-Ikhlas. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Who amongst you would want to read one third of the Quran every night?" The Sahaba said, "Who can manage this, O Messenger of Allah? Who can read 10 juz a night?" So he said, "I will tell you a surah. If you read it, you will get one third of the Quran. That is Surah Al-Ikhlas." Why is Surah Al-Ikhlas? Why is Ayatul Kursi so blessed and holy? Because the content of these ayat and surahs is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the names and attributes of Allah jalla jalaluhu. And very briefly, in just 4 or 5 minutes, I'm going to quickly go over Ayatul Kursi. Otherwise, of course, the real tafsir of Ayatul Kursi will take us many, many hours. But we should know some basic meanings of this great ayah. Allah says, Allahu la ilaha illahu al-hayyul qayyum. Allah, and this is, as we know, the primary name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has many names, infinite number of names. And of these are 99 that are extra special and holy. And of these 99, the most common of Allah's names is the name Allah. There is no name in the Quran that is more common than this name, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the first name mentioned in the Quran. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. It is the last name mentioned in the Quran. Qul a'udhu bi Rabbin Nasi, Malikin Nasi, Ilahin Nas. It is a name that occurs over 3,500 times. That means at least half of the Quran, of the ayat of the Quran, include this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a name that Allah has mentioned and revealed in all of the books. To this day, the Old and New Testament are full of the references of Eloh and Elohim. And this is Allah and Allahum. This is how the Jews and the earlier generations would say the name of Allah, Eloh and Elohim, Allah and Allahum. And the meaning of this phrase or this word or this name is a very deep topic, and there's many opinions. Where does it mean? Is there a meaning or not? Some scholars say it is a proper noun, ismun jamid. Others say it is mushtaq, it is derived. The correct opinion is that this name might be derived from certain verbs. Of them is the verb walaha. And walaha means qasada, which means to reach out to want, to desire. So it is as if Allah Azza wa Jal is the object that all the creation is desiring. The ultimate goal is Allah. And that's one of the meanings of the name of Allah. Another meaning that can be derived from the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, it is from Alaha Ya'lahu. And Alaha means Tahayyara. And Tahayyara means to be astounded and confused. It is as if when you think about Allah Azza wa Jal, you're full of awe, you're full of amazement. The beauty, the majesty of Allah. Your mind cannot grasp Allah. So you become astounded and amazed and confused. And this is one of the meanings of Allah. Of the meanings of Allah Azza wa Jal, the name Allah, and this is the most academic meaning, is Allah, that the name Allah comes from Aliha Ya'lahu, which means Abada Ya'badu. So Allah is Al-Ma'bud. Allah is the one who is worthy of worship. And this is perhaps the most academic meaning, that Allah is the one, this is the meaning, the one who is worthy of being venerated and worshipped. This is what Allah means. And therefore Allah affirms this by saying, Allahu la ilaha illahu. And la ilaha illahu, this of course it means, and sadly many Muslims, they mistranslate the kalima and they say there's no God but God, or there's no Lord but God, or there's no creator but Allah. These are all incorrect translations and they do not do justice to the kalima. The proper translation of the kalima is, there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah. La ilaha illahu. There's no deity worthy of worship. What is worship? Worship is veneration. Worship is submitting yourself to. And if you look around you, mankind always submits to beings other than Allah, except for the true Muslim. Some people submit to false gods, others submit to their desires, others submit to materialism and money, and they worship money, i.e. they submit to money. Whatever will get me money, I will do it. This is submission. This is worship, right? So Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, Allahu la ilaha illahu. There is nothing we will submit to. We will obey, we will sacrifice for other than Allah. La ilaha illahu. He is Al-Hay Al-Qayyum. Al-Hay, the one who has perfect hayat, life. So Allah Azza wa Jal is Al-Hay because not only does He have life, He has perfect life and He gives life. None of us has perfect life and none of us can create and give life. All of our lives are deficient. Allah gives us our life. And then once we are alive, we need food, we need water, we need rest, we need sleep. And every life is followed by death, except for Al-Hay. Al-Hay does not need anything. Al-Hay, the one who is self-subsisting. Al-Hay, he does not get tired. That's why Allah says, لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. Sina means he gets drowsy. Just falling asleep like this is a sina. And nawm means to go asleep. So the perfection of Allah's hayat is that He doesn't even get tired. He doesn't need to eat and drink. Allah says in the Quran that He doesn't want any food from you. He gives you food. Allah says, وَهُوَ يُطْعِمُ وَلَا يُطْعَمُ. Allah gives you ta'am. He doesn't take ta'am. He doesn't take food. This is Al-Hay, the ever-living. Al-Qayyum. Al-Qayyum means the one who gives others all that they need. So Al-Hay goes back to Allah. Al-Qayyum goes back to the creation. Al-Hay can take care of himself. Al-Qayyum takes care of everything else. So Allah Azza wa Jal is Al-Hay. He doesn't need you. And He is Al-Qayyum. You need Him. Qayyum, he gives you. Qa'imun ala kulli nafs, Allah says in the Quran. Amman huwa qa'imun ala kulli nafs mimma kasabat. Allah is the one who takes care of every being's needs. This is al-qayyum. So Allah Azza wa Jal is al-hayy in himself, and he's al-qayyum for the rest of the creation, that he takes care of the creation. La ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm, we explained, this is the perfection. If Allah Azza wa Jal does not even get tired, he does not even get sleepy, then he doesn't need food, he doesn't need anything. Allah is al-ghani, he is free of any needs. La ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm. Lahu ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard. Every other being besides him belongs to him. Every other being belongs to Allah. Lahu, complete ownership. And complete ownership means nothing happens in this world except that Allah has willed it, except that Allah knows about it, except that Allah has created it. Lahu ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard. The entire creations in the heavens and earth, they belong to Allah Azza wa Jal. Lahu ma fis sama, such is his perfection. He says, "Man dhal ladhi yashfa'u indahu illa bi'idhnih." It's a rhetorical question. It's a rhetorical question that is meant to indicate his ultimate power. Who can possibly even intercede? You see, the least form of power is intercession. This is the least form of power. Higher than this, you control. Higher than this, you create. Higher than this, you are in charge. Shafa'a means you go to the owner. This is the least form. And you beg the owner, please can you hire my nephew? Please can you give me this and that? This is shafa'a, right? Allah is saying, you cannot even ask shafa'a, much less actually do something, except if Allah allows it. Man dhal ladhi yashfa? And this is the least form of power, right? As we said, higher than this is the one that you go to. He owns, for example, the company, the boss of the company, right? If you know him, you will go and get shafa'a from him. That I have a friend, can you hire him? Can you give me a pay raise? This is shafa'a, right? Allah is saying you cannot even ask shafa'a from him unless he allows you to do so. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَى عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. Allah knows what is in front of them and behind them. Of course, there's a clear meaning here. Allah knows what is around us. But there's a more profound meaning. Allah knows what is in front of them, meaning what will happen to them in the future, meaning the akhirah. And what is behind them, meaning what they have done that everybody else thinks is hidden. Allah knows what's going to happen tomorrow. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ. Allah knows what's going to happen in the next life. وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. Allah knows what you did in hidden and secret. Allah knows when nobody was looking, when everybody thought that you're all alone, Allah knows what happened. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. So Allah knows everything about you. As for you and as for the creation, they know nothing. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ بِشَيْءٍ هَذِي نَكِرَ فِي سِيَاقِ النَّفِي. Basically it means this is a complete, absence of knowledge. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ. They have nothing of Allah's knowledge. The rest of the creation do not share Allah's knowledge except if Allah tells them. إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. As Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا أُتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. You have only been given a small amount of knowledge. As Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Above everybody of some knowledge, there is Al-Alim, who has all knowledge. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, even in the attribute of knowledge, and as we say, knowledge is power, right? Knowledge is the basis of everything. When you know, then you can create, you can judge, you can rule. Knowledge is the basis of power. So Allah says, my knowledge is complete. Your knowledge is nothing unless I give you a little. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ لَا بِمَا شَاءَ وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. His kursi. Scholars have differed what is the kursi, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best, but there appears to be a creation of Allah that is different than the arsh, that is different than the throne. Allah mentions two things in the Quran, the arsh and the kursi. Allah mentions the arsh in 7 verses, 11 verses. And Allah mentions the kursi in 1 verse. This is the only verse in the Quran that Allah mentions the kursi. And we don't know much about this other than the kursi is one of the largest and the most magnificent creations of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Allah says, His kursi encompasses all of this that you know around you. What we think is the world, his kursi is larger than that. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. And he never becomes tired. يَؤُودُ يَأَدَى means to become tired. ثَقُلَ عَلَيْهِ وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. That he never becomes tired of taking care of the entire creation. Every single being is taken care of. The air that you breathe, the water that I drink, Allah has destined it for you. Allah knows it. كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْن. Every day Allah Azza wa Jal is taking care of every being. وَلَا يَؤُودُ حِفْظُهُمَا. All of these billions of beasts and creatures, Allah says, even that which crawls in the land, that which swims in the ocean, there is nothing except that Allah is giving its sustenance to it. Allah has everything in it. Right? And Ibn Abbas was asked once that, oh Ibn Abbas, how can Allah speak to all of mankind at the same time on Yawm Al-Qiyamah? That's what the Quran says, that Allah will speak to all of us at the same time. Ibn Abbas said, the way that he took care of them all at the same time in this world. The way that he took care of them all at the same time in this world, why can't he speak to them all at the same time? وَلَا يَؤُدُوا حِفْظُهُمَا. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. And these are two of the majestic names of Allah, the comprehensive names of Allah. The names of Allah are divided into at least five categories, and Al-Ali Al-Azim, they both go in one category, which is basically the category of, it's difficult to translate this, but basically the majestic, broad names of Allah. They have many meanings. It's not just a specific meaning such as Rahman, such as Ghafoor. These are specific meanings. Al-Ali and Al-Azim, they are broad meanings. They encompass many meanings. Al-Ali means the exalted. So Allah Azza wa Jal is exalted in His essence. He is above us. He is exalted in His might. He is exalted in His knowledge. Al-Ali, there is nothing greater than Allah. سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. This is Al-A'la, the most grandiose. And Al-Azim means something similar for us in English. It's difficult to translate in the khutbah, the differences. Al-Azim again means the majestic and the great. Al-Azim, there is nothing that is greater than Allah Azza wa Jal. This one verse has more than 20 of Allah's names and attributes. And in fact, the whole verse from beginning to end is nothing other than the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is because of this that this verse is the greatest verse in the Quran. I remind myself and all of you that we should be repeating and memorizing this verse and repeating it day and night, morning and evening, and after the end of every single salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who enter Jannah bighayri hisabin wala adhab. Wa akhru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.